with reference to heat and cold. Shitoshna sukadukkeshu. Tatha, so too. Mana apamana yoho. With reference to praise and criticism. Jitatmanaha prashantasya atma param samahitaha or paramatma samahitaha. So, shitoshna sukadukkeshu tatha manapamana yoho jitatmanaha prashantasya both are shashti and then atma param samahitaha paramatma samahitaha. This is called Anvaya for those who are not studying Sanskrit. Rearranging the words of the shloka to form a sentence. A sentence is something that should immediately tell us, you know, what is the subject or with action. Everything becomes clear when it is in a sentence form. That's what we are doing here. And shlokas need not have that sentence form. And in Sanskrit, it's very easy to do because a word can be positioned anywhere and still the meaning of the sentence will not change. So that's the beauty of Sanskrit. Okay. Any questions? Swapna, is that okay? Yeah.
Guruji, I have heard another definition of anger. Like you said about holding charcoal, hot charcoal to throw at someone. The other one I have heard is, anger is like you having poison and expecting the other person to die.
Oh, I see. Okay.
Even literally, when you're angry, there's a lot of chemical reaction happening inside, which is not good for you. Right? And you are angry at someone else, nothing happens to him or her. So you having poison, expecting the other person to die.
Correct. Yeah, nothing happens to him or her. Unless they are your spouse or they are your children, right? So that's the problem. Yeah, they become a victim of our anger. So that's, we have to be very careful about that.
No questions.
Okay. So no questions. So let's, JG, go ahead.
So shall I close this recording and start new one or?
No, go ahead.
Okay. Okay, so I wanted to share my learning from the chapter 3rd and 4th, mainly 3rd, a little bit about 4th. So one thing I realized is Bhagavad Gita, like we started off saying, encyclopedia of life and all, and also a good book on mind management, right? A lot about understanding how the mind functions. So that was one thing. And the 3rd chapter started giving us a very clear idea on how important karma yoga is. Even earlier, I used to think that jnana yoga is the only way to get moksha or the ultimate thing. But here it was very clearly, Bhagwan told us that there are two parts and both are equally important. Then the concept of yajna was something which was very interesting. So everything that is happening in the creation, in the universe, actually is more like it's happening. It's all set in motion and it's constantly happening. And we all have some specific role to play in this whole journey. So it became very clear that earlier I used to think that we have to make things happen. Now it's more like letting things happen. It's not much of we really doing it. It's happening through us, but it's all like a happening that is. So that distinction came, a clear idea about letting things happen rather than making things happen. Because the whole creation has come together to make everything happen. The other thing was about karma yoga. When I have also tried to implement in my life, whenever I'm doing something without attachment to the fruits, okay, we have learned earlier also, but it's like, what should I say? Your efficiency improves if you're not thinking about the result. And it happens many times in seva. In seva, there is not too much of expectation on the result. you're doing it just for the sake of doing. That action itself is divine. So that also was a good revelation when I went through the chapter again. Then there was a question about what makes man commit papa. Arjuna had asked Bhagwan. So there, again, Bhagwan gave us a beautiful explanation about how kama and krodha, and how kama leads to krodha. So that again was a good thing to learn. And the fact that desires, we think desires once fulfilled will give us happiness. But desire is like a fire. The more you satisfy, the more and more it will want. It continues to burn more. So that again is a learning that satisfying desire is not the answer. Somehow binding desires I'm talking about. So how to slowly get out of it is what is the key. Yeah, raga, dvesha are the internal enemies. So that again was something that I had noted. Then one thing which I found is we say that jnana is the ultimate. So one of the reasons which, Guruji, you can correct me, like life is also like climbing a tree, and we are holding on to different branches at different stages of life. And the branch you hold, it could be weak, you know. If it's a weak branch, you are likely to fall. And jnana and divine is a branch which probably is really strong. If you can hold on to it, there is no other thing that can affect it. Meaning it is up to you how strongly you hold it. That will not fall. And that doesn't go away from you. You can be attached only to that which doesn't change, which is permanent. We kept talking about impermanence of other things. But this is one thing which I think if you hold on to divine or knowledge, it is the pakka permanent branch. You can hold it and climb and reach where you have to reach ultimately. So that was anchoring to the divine or knowledge keeps the heart safe and the mind sane, as there is no danger of breaking it. This is something that came. Then this again, mind is like, I heard it somewhere, I don't remember where. Mind is like a glue. So it can quickly attach itself to anything. Now it's up to you as to what you want to attach it to. If you attach it to the material, worldly things, yes, it is going to go away and then you are again shattered. So what you hold on to is very important. Then different forms of yajnas, which was mentioned in chapter 4, that was also very interesting. And how to approach the guru, how to ask questions, how to be humble, because arrogance is one of the dangerous thing on this path. So that was on the chapter 4 that I had seen. And chapter 4 that everything, seeing everything as Brahma, the 4.27, I think, no? Where Brahma, Brahma, that shloka is also a very interesting one. Seeing everything as Brahma, action that you do, what is being offered, everything is Brahma. So that also was very interesting. So a lot of learning, still getting grip on that, but overall, I think two chapters which made Karma Yoga's importance very clear, and also at the same time learning to let go of things and not being actionless, but doing the action at the same time, not worrying about what the result is. And I think that's where Seva comes in as a form of karma, but at the same time, not attaching too much to the end fruits of the action. So that's briefly what I wanted to say. Thanks.
Thank you, Vijay.
Thank you.
Good, yeah. Those are good learnings from chapters 3 and 4. So is jnanam satyam or mithya? Anybody can ask. Did I?
Yeah, satyam. Ultimately.
Okay. Anybody can mute themselves. Yeah. Jnanam is satyam, you feel, huh?
I feel it is satyam, but maybe at some point you have to go beyond that also, I guess. But till the time you reach there, jnanam is what you can hold because no one can take it away from you.
Okay.
Jnanam is satyam, Jai Kumar ji. It need not have to be satyam. It is a nityam. Always.
But according to Advaita, Brahman is the only satyam.
Okay. Everything Mohani, else is Brahman is only satyam. Narasimha Prasad.
Paramarthika satya paramarthika mithya prapanchika satya.
What is it again?
Paramarthika satya.
Paramarthika, when we take in the absolute terms, it is mithya, jnanam. But in the prapanchika, in the duality, we
Okay. Sunita, Chavendra.
I think it is mithya. Intellectually, like how Narasimha Prasad ji said, transactionally it may be satya, but
right.
Paramarthically it is mithya.
Bhagya.
Yeah, same thing.
Yeah, right.
Intellectually you feel that it is satya, but I don't think it is.
Yeah, so
jnanam need not have to be satyam. Jnanam is always nitya, whether the false or the truth. Is a jnanam is a jnanam.
Yeah.
So, can I say, Jay Kumar?
Yeah, Prasad, go ahead, please.
See, Shastram is jnanam and Shastram is a pramana, so it is not mithya, it is satya.
Okay. So now you can understand, right? There is two answers to this question. Satyam and mithya, both are there. So, jnana, if you look at jnana, knowledge, knowledge occurs in our mind of any object, anything, including that of Atma. Okay. So since knowledge takes place, knowledge is a vritti. What is knowledge? It's a vritti. It's something that says, yeah, I got it. I know it. 2 + 3 = 5. I got it. Long ago, I got it. No, there's no, and that knowledge stays with you. But then if there is something for which you have to say, I got it, well, that means before that, you did not get it. Before that, I didn't know. Anything you know, if there was a time before which you didn't know that. So therefore it has to be mithya, anitya. Because for knowledge to take place, Atma must be there. Without Atma, there is no knowledge of anything, including knowledge of Atma. Correct? Atma must exist. I must be there for knowledge to take place. Therefore, I am satyam. Jnanam is not satyam. Jnanam is mithya.
Okay?
Yeah. Important to keep in mind. Now, so Haraprasad is saying Atma Vidya, Shastram, Veda. Veda is saying all these things. How can you say this knowledge is mithya? That is what Haraprasad is saying. Well, I am not saying this. Mundaka Upanishad says this. You know what it says? It says, Ve Vidya Veditavya. Okay? Itihasma. And then, paracha parachaiva, like that it says. So there are two kinds of knowledge, vidya, okay? Paravidya and aparavidya. Then the Upanishad goes a little further and says, we want to know what aparavidya is. And then big list it gives. And then in that list, you know what it says? Rigvedaha, Yajurvedaha, Samavedaha, Atharvanacha, like that it says. When I read this, I got a first shock in my life. I was all along thinking Veda is Paravidya. But Mundaka Upanishad, which is part of the Veda, says all this is Aparavidya. Okay, Aparavidya means knowledge of the non-self. Then what is this Paravidya, you tell me? Mundaka Upanishad says very clearly, Yaya Brahma Adhigamyate. That which gives you the knowledge of Brahma. It doesn't give a categorical answer also. That which gives you the knowledge of Brahma and then leaves it at that. That means what do you understand? All the words of the Veda, huge Veda, all the words, mithya. Sanskrit language, mithya. Sacred Deva Bhasha, mithya.
Yato vacho nivartante.
Yato vacho nivartante. So that refers to the fact that you can't categorically define Brahma. So everything is nitya. Deva Bhasha is nitya. My God, yeah, it's nitya only. And so Vedas also is nitya. All words are nitya. Language is nitya. Then jnanam is also nitya. Okay, that is satyam nitya. This we have to be clear about. And it doesn't mean the sanctity of the Vedas is gone. No, Vedas is very sacred for us. Vedas is Veda Mata can never be non-sacred. No, sacred for us. And so we have no problem with that. But mithya, you must have the courage to say Vedas are mithya. Correct? We are just making an objective statement. That's all. What about Krishna Avatara, Satyam or Mithya? Somebody asks you, what will you say?
Mithya.
Mithya.
Correct? Mithya. You have to say Mithya only. When Krishna asks
Ishvara
you.
Ishvara is Mithya. You have to go beyond Ishvara for the Brahman.
Krishna will come in your dream or he may come because you are studying Gita and all and you are doing a lot of seva. So you will come one day and says, I am Krishna. Oh, Krishna, you do namaskar and all. Am I Satyam or Mithya? He will ask you because you are studying all these things. He may ask you that question. You must be ready with an answer. Okay. So yeah, Avatara is Mithya.
How about Rama? How do you classify?
Rama. How do you classify? Yeah, I also have the same question.
Mithya.
Okay.
How about Rama? Go for Satya. Rama.
Rama is Satyam, says Rameshji. What about anybody? Any other answers?
No, I think Mithya.
Ishvara, any form if you take it is Mithya.
Okay, yeah. Mahesh says Mithya. So, Mohini says any form of Ishvara is Mithya.
Namarupa is Mithya, right? So any name form is
Ishvara is Mithya. Correct.
Because it's not permanent, it's a defined period.
Right. So Ramesh, the way to think about this is?
It's dependent.
I will say still Satya because he is the most ideal person any Purana siddha. Starting from childhood, and when he follows his father's, even though his father promised his wife, Rama acknowledged just one, goes to Vanavasa, and then even after that, when he comes back, if somebody blames Sita, for that he sends Sita back. That's the only part I don't like, he said. Other than that, Rama is the ideal person in my opinion.
Okay, so we will get Dr. Satya's opinion also. Satya ji, go ahead. Unmute yourself, please.
For me, the easiest way to remember what is nitya, permanent, or real, what is anitya, unreal, is anything that changes with time and space is anitya. It is not permanent. Anything that is independent and does not change with time and space, that is nitya. If we follow that principle, it is easy to identify what is anitya and what is nitya, what is permanent and what is real, what is unreal.
Yeah. So we've got various answers. So yeah, what changes with time and space is anitya. Anitya means not permanent. And what is permanent is atma. Atma is nityam and atma is satyam. And anityam is mithya. So there is a one-to-one correspondence there. How did we define mithya as? That which depends on something else for its existence is mithya. That which does not depend on anything for its existence. That which is self-existent is satyam. That's how we define it. So by these definitions, we have to say, if you say you are talking about a person or avatara who was born, however ideal that person is, then we say that avatara is mithya. Okay? Because born and also, if it died, did Rama die? If you say, well, it doesn't matter if Rama died or not. If you say Rama is born, then that is enough to say Rama is mithya. Very important mithya for us. Mithya doesn't mean unimportant. Mithya does not mean not sacred. Mithya does not mean trash. We survive because of mithya only. Okay. Mithya body needs mithya air, mithya water, mithya food, mithya house, mithya family. Okay.
Yeah.
don't put down mithya. Mithya avatara is also mithya. Krishna avatara mithya. We have all mithyas, and mithya needs mithya. No doubt about that. So one more point, Ramesh, he said, I don't like this thing that Rama sent Sita to this fire and all. One good thing is, Valmiki did not write it. Valmiki Ramayana does not have it. But then, any of you studying Sanskrit can be inspired and you can write your own Ramayana. And then in the future, it will be known as Satya Ramayana, Vijay Ramayana, or you know, Shailaja Ramayana. Anything can be there. Yeah, possible. It's possible. Anybody can write Ramayana, and if you are good at Sanskrit, etc., or in your own language, why Sanskrit? Tulsi Ramayana is in Hindi, Kamba Ramayana is in Tamil, and there are so many Ramayanas in Telugu. Okay, so what is that? So you can write. Now, when you write
Ramayana,
Adhyatma Ramayana is there. When you write it, do you have to go exactly what Valmiki says? Is it a translation of Valmiki Ramayana? No, not at all. It's your own. Now you are free to imagine and say, and maybe your Ravana does not have 10 heads. That is also fine. Like that, somebody said, he became over enthusiastic, in my opinion, and said, you know, he went stretched, extrapolated even more and said, Rama is such a great person. He is willing to just let go of Sita and put Sita through all these things. Okay, some people don't like it, some people don't mind it, some people ignore it, all this happens, but it is not part of Valmiki Ramayana. Okay, just one
Dekhmati, it is there in the Shadashloki Ramayana, right? That he asks Sita to enter the fire, it's there in Shadashloki
Ramayana, is it?
Yeah, that is part of Valmiki Ramayana.
Okay, Chakracharya Shadashloki is there. And that's the only Shatashloki I know. But no.
The first 100 verses of the.
Yeah, the first 100 verses.
Shatashloki.
Narada. Yeah.
Yeah, I'm saying it can be there anywhere. It is not in Valmiki Ramayana. That's what I'm saying.
But it is part of Valmiki Ramayana.
What is part of Valmiki Ramayana?
The Shatashloki is part of Valmiki Ramayana.
You will have to check. I'll have to check. Send me a link to the Shatashloki.
Yeah, the first 100 verses is the Shatashloki Ramayana.
Send me a link to that, okay?
Okay.
Yeah. So there are so these days when you get this book called Ramayana, it's a thick book. The entire, you know, all the shlokas, 64,000 shlokas will be there. And then so scholars have looked into this and to see was everything actually written by Valmiki? Like that there's been a lot of discussion. Because it's hard to figure out. And then they have carefully looked at it. And they, in that book, sometimes in the chapter, the beginning of the chapter, they would say, scholars think this is not written by Valmiki. Like that. Okay. And the agreement on this Uttara Ramayana, this is called Uttara Ramayana, this Sita, you know, entering the fire and things like that. And say Valmiki has not written it. That's what our Swamis also have said. Tattva Yudhananda ji says that. Swami Dayananda ji says that. And so that's what I've heard. So let's look into that. Shatashloki Ramayana. Let's see. Let me.
It's part of Balakanda, basically the first sarga of Balakanda.
First sarga of Balakanda. Yeah, but whether Shatashloki is part of Valmiki Ramayana or not, we need to look into that.
Yeah.
Another example for anger that is given usually is the matchstick. You light the matchstick to burn others, but what happens to the matchstick? Like, it burns first. Before lighting others, it gets burnt first.
Right. Matchstick. Coal, poison.
Mm-hmm.
Good examples. Now, anger is a very, it's something we have to look into. Because I think it's a learned response. I think we should have Anjali talk about this. It's a learned response. I think the child learns that response from the parents. And somehow it thinks that it's a way to get things done. You're not doing it. That means what? So maybe that creates fear in other people, you know, and the father or mother does that. If the child is afraid about it. So it does seem to work for the child at least. And so
you expect something to happen your way, and if it doesn't, then that is when it gets started, is that anger, that frustration, and you know, you can, it can go to any extent depending on how much resources or emotional stability you have.
True. And that's what we've studied. Yes, that is true. But then it seems to work at home. The child responds to anger. Okay, so the parent continues to use that. If it never works, maybe we get some feedback and it's actually going the opposite direction. Then that's one thing. But it seems to work. The child does respond and the parent is angry and responds the way the parents would like. And so there is some psychology there that we need to look into. Yeah, Maheshi, go ahead.
I was saying it works only when, as long as child is a child. It doesn't work after that at all.
Yeah, obviously.
One other thing, Jagamaji, in slogan, the translation we did in 6.7, is that sukha dukkha, you translated as pleasure and pain. Is it a pleasure and sorrow, a better translation?
Pleasure and pain. Yeah, I'm curious. I think, are these pleasure and pain opposites? I mean, they say pleasure in English, do they say pain? Yes.
I mean, dukkha, the way I understood when I learned Sanskrit, is not a pain, but it is a sorrow.
Happiness.
Yeah.
Happiness and sorrow. Okay, well, then let me put it.
Yeah, if you use happiness, then you have to say sorrow. If you say pleasure, you have to say pain. I think that's pain.
That's something. Pain is something like, I don't know. I mean, pain can be like, I may not be, I may be angry because of pain. Doesn't mean I need to be sorrow because of pain. Like I fall down.
The way to look at this, sukha means that which you desire. Dukkha means anything that you do not desire. That is the meaning of this. So anything I get that I don't desire. Now, how I respond to that is anybody's guess. But dukkha means what I don't want. When I get what I don't want, then that is situation is called dukkha. And I can be upset, I can be depressed, or I can just say, my goodness, this is how, what should I do next? You know, pretty bad and I need to work. I need to go do it again all the way. Whatever, you have to respond to that. And so that is one way to look at it. Sukha is ishta, ishta vastu praptihi. Dukkha is ishta vastu anishta vastu prapti. Anything, whatever I don't want to happen in my life, you list, make a list of things. And then that becomes a cause for dukkha. Okay.
So it can be what I meant was, when you say pleasure is a state of mind. So is the sorrow, whereas pain is something, it affects your body, you feel it. That's the reason I said that.
Yeah, here the assumption is made that pain is of course undesirable. You can say pain and sorrow. Yeah, look at pain and sorrow. If that helps you, I think that's a better translation for this.
Physical pain is body pain. You could have non-physical pain also, no?
Mental pain.
Now, here pain can be both emotional and physical.
Which is sorrow. Right?
Which is sorrow. Okay, there you go. If you include emotional pain, then it is sorrow. Yeah.
By definition, the pain is both physical, emotional, unpleasant condition causing any situation is pain. Not necessarily only physical. Psychological pain also included.
Yeah, true. I agree with that. So by that definition, I think pain is okay.
Narayananji had some question. Yeah. Your hand was raised.
Yeah, my hand was raised, but I thought we passed the moment. So I was only saying that one more definition of anger which I have heard is is the punishment you give yourself for somebody else's mistake.
That's a good one. I like that. punishment you give yourself for somebody else's mistake. Yeah, I think we should keep that in mind. Yeah.
And it is also told, you know, it is one letter short of danger.
Anger.
Oh, sorry, guys, say that again. One?
One letter short of danger.
Oh, one letter short of danger. I like that also. That's also very good. One letter short of danger, and anger is what happens to you, for what you do to yourself for somebody else's mistake.
Punish yourself.
Punishment for yourself or somebody's mistake.
Okay.
You know, Guruji, Swapna would probably add to this, but what we say sometimes is anger is an emotion that covers up hurt. And so sometimes when you're hurt, you express it in an angry way because it's an easier emotion and it's more acceptable than admitting that you're hurt. I don't know, what do you think about that, Swapna?
No, I agree.
Yeah. So the bottom line is, when you're feeling angry, go inwards and think, what is hurting? What is it that's really going on that I'm feeling angry?
Correct. You're right. Yeah. Right. Admitting. I mean, if not admitting hurt, admit to oneself that there is a pain underneath.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
If not for others. Yeah. So this definition is what? This is a causal kind of definition. Anger is that which covers the pain that is there underneath, correct?
Yeah.
Which is used to cover the pain, or involuntarily it happens, right?
Or even pain expressed as anger.
Oh, okay.
Pain expressed as anger, okay.
More than anger, pain, people express as frustration. Angry with the physician, if they continue to have the pain and frustrated.
So who is frustrated in that case? Say that again.
Patient is more frustrated when
they continue to have the pain. Yeah, exactly. Yeah, it's not wise for the patient to quickly get angry with the doctors, you know. So,
but in America, that's the first thing they think, that I came to you with the pain. It's your problem now. It's not my problem anymore. You take care of it, like that. That response.
Correct. That's a very interesting difference between our country and America.
Here, there is no personal responsibility as far as health is concerned. It's somebody else's responsibility for you to be healthy.
Yeah.
I mean, just look at the unvaccinated patients, Chikumarji. They don't accept that they need to get vaccinated. And this is supposed to be the most developed country in the entire world.
Mohiniji, in America, a lot of things are underdeveloped.
I know, it is considered. That's why I said considered. It is not real.
Considered, yeah, absolutely. Yeah. And spiritually and culturally, these guys are morally most underdeveloped country. This is.
You know, I met recently a person here only in India. And that person, in India, like you all have social security numbers. Here, we have an Aadhaar card number, PAN number, etc. So this person refuses to get an Aadhaar card. The person is highly educated, he's working in a good company and all that. Okay. He says, I'm not going to get an Aadhaar card. I will not give my fingerprints to the government. Okay. Now, there is a little bit of truth in all these things. I don't completely put these things down. Yeah, truth is there, because now you're not going, we may use it against me, and you know, it's my identity and all. But he took it to the extreme and he said, no, I'm not bank, no Aadhaar card. At the KYC, yeah, I think the banks are the biggest failure is this, they could not get the Aadhaar card of this person. The whole entire bank system has failed. And so, it's a So I know the person from a long time, but yeah. And so those people are there, which is, I mean, you need some pushback on all these things, no doubt. I like that, that attitude of pushback. But to see somebody who said this, I was amazed to hear that. But America, they pushed it. They will burn flags and they will do all these things. So it's amazing. That's another nice.
I call this educated illiterates. The guy's response like this: paranoid, educated illiterates.
Amazing. Yeah. Okay, it's 8:15 here, so we will pause. Thank you. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya Dhanvantaraye Amrita Kalachahastaya Sarvamaya Vinashanaya Trailokyanathaya Shri Mahavishnave Namaha. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya Dhanvantaraye Amrita Kalachahastaya Sarvamaya Vinashanaya Trailokyanathaya Shri Mahavishnave Namaha. ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय धन्वंतरये अमृतकलशहस्ताय सर्वामय विनाशनाय त्रैलोक्यनाथाय श्री महाविष्णुवे नमः. थैंक यू. सी यू ऑल नेक्स्ट.